Jessica Kingsley Publishers, an imprint of John Murray Press, presents Low Demand Parenting: Dropping Demands, Restoring Calm, and Finding Connection with Your Uniquely Wired Child, by Amanda Diekman. Read by Lauryn Allman. A PDF of resources is attached to the audiobook. Chapter 1. My Story. I had three boys in 4 years, each of them with their own cluster of uniqueness, personality, diagnoses, and neurological differences. We are a proudly neurodiverse family, as well as a mixed neurology family, and together we have created a vibrant, low-demand family culture. But it has not always been easy. Before I became a parent, I was pretty confident I'd be a good one. When my first son was born, I was so endlessly in love with him that I couldn't sleep. Exhausted, I would lie awake watching him breathe, admiring the tiny faces he made in slumber, awash in the reverie of new motherhood. When I gave birth to my third son in 4 years, I was still hopelessly in love with my children, but parenthood was killing me. My oldest son, Owen, changed his clothes dozens of times each day, banged his head on walls, and faked injuries. Our house filled with his screams as he seemed to struggle with every transition of every day. We balanced on the head of a pin, trying to get it right every time to prevent a catastrophic meltdown. I could not carry on with my life as it was. I left my job and dedicated myself to figuring out what was happening in my family. Every aspect of our parenting life was so incredibly difficult, and I had no reference point because, if anything, my second child, Michael, was more difficult than my first. He was a ball of rage, a ticking time bomb, and we never knew what would set him off. The triggers were endless. In his dysregulated state, he was like a wild animal, desperate to destroy in order to survive. He ripped apart books that we placed in his crib. He destroyed his toys. The play therapist commented that 4-year-old Owen seemed terrified of his younger brother. At 2, Michael came out of his silent shell one day by unexpectedly yelling, "My die you!" at kids on the playground, pushing them and biting them without provocation. From then on, I perpetually hovered a hand's length away to keep other children safe from his uncontrolled aggression. He would bend down to kiss my newborn Leo and then punch him in the face. My bedrock assumption that I was a good parent was on extremely shaky ground. The daily challenges pushed my nervous system beyond its breaking point. The deep waters of postpartum depression rose up, and I was drowning. My children's meltdowns focused intensely on me. I was covered in bruises. We had a few near misses where someone almost got really hurt. A permanent jagged scar on one child's eyelid is a daily reminder of just how close that rock came. My body was so tense it hurt. My muscles ached when I finally laid down at night. I tried progressive muscle relaxation by tensing and releasing muscles, a technique I read about on the internet and decided to try. But tensing up my muscles was so familiar from surviving all the day's disasters that it made me weep. Tears like a winter rain, a steady, all-day rain, interminable, miserable. I never got to the relaxation part. I just fell into pieces. I tried to talk to other parents about what I was facing. "It's really hard to get your kids dressed, right?" I would casually ask, desperate for someone whose story reflected mine. "Yeah," they would say with a shrug. "Kids can be so picky." "So, does it take you an hour to get them dressed? Do they have elaborate rituals to tie their shoes? Do they hit you, scream in your face? Are you walking on eggshells all the time?" Startled, blank faces stared back at me as heads slowly shook. "No, no, it's not like that for us. You should see a therapist." When we started therapy, if anything, it got worse. The psychologist proposed a more rigid set of expectations, rewards, and punishments. When I calmly, lovingly shared this plan, my 4-year-old turned to his younger brother. "Come on, let's get her," he said, and the two of them attacked. They punched and scratched me as I sacrificed myself to protect the baby, and then they ran out the front door, slamming it behind them. I dissolved into tears. That is not how it was supposed to go. I'm getting this all wrong. Why is this happening? Desperate for solutions, I turned to parenting books to guide me. One of my parenting gurus made me believe that holding boundaries with kids is the most important thing. I found myself holding firm to all kinds of bizarre things that I said but didn't mean. "I told you if you didn't keep 2 hands on the grocery cart, I would put back those Oreos. If you even look at your brother, we're leaving." I began to even annoy myself with my rules and expectations, and I was drowning in follow-through. My children observed and latched on to my obsession with consistency. They began pointing out each rule that another broke and insisting on punishment. Our family culture became warped around this oppressive cause and effect parenting. We were all trapped. My middle child, Michael, began to say, "Fine, kick me out of the family," to show me that no matter what punishment I sent his way, he would not care. He would not bend. I looked in the mirror and did not recognize this person, a familiar experience. I had always struggled with masks, camouflaging like a chameleon. For nearly 4 decades, I wanted nothing more than to be normal. I blurred any harsh edges of my personality, ceased having opinions, and cultivated all my most universally likable traits to ensure that the largest number of people would like me at all times. It was exhausting to be so likable all the time. I held myself to the highest standards and never let myself off the hook. The punishment for breaking a social rule was the pain of feeling different. So I was a careful critic of my own abnormality. I will be liked. I will be safe. No one can hurt me if I do not have any me to be hurt. I held boundaries everywhere, with my kids, with myself. I never ceased playing the part. For 38 years, I believed that this universally likable mask was myself, and that the immense effort it took to play that part was simply my fault. Not knowing what it felt like to inhabit anyone else's skin, I assumed that others were trying just as hard, but made it look easier. They played their parts and did it better. I was simply not coping well with the reality of being human. I reread my parenting books, looking for the places where they admit that sometimes, even when you do your best, these strategies don't work as planned. I kept searching for the sections where they described kids who don't fit the paradigm or gave me a template for finding my way back to their right path from the deep, dark, scary woods on either side where we seemed to have stumbled. But no, the system doesn't fail. The parents fail. The parents fail to implement the system properly. This was what my parenting gurus led me to believe. I have failed. I am alone in the dark. my fear grew. We were off the path, and no one seemed to see us. The gurus kept insisting that if I was just consistent enough, if I tried hard enough, if I didn't give in, then my kids would be okay, that we could have a future of joy and success. I dreamt of this happy future all the time, the day when I finally got it right and we would experience the calm and ease that other families seemingly accessed all the time. I dreamt of quiet crafting projects that ended in lovely creations that made us all proud, instead of ending with creations ripped into tiny pieces and the sounds of screams echoing around the house. I dreamt of family meals where everyone shared something that happened in their day, full of warm connection over lovingly prepared food, a ritual that eased us into the drowsy connection of cozy bedtimes. Each night, I expected my fantasy, not the reality of our dinners. When the smell of my lovingly prepared food sent one child under the table, making gagging and retching noises like a cat with a hairball. I never seemed to expect the pervasive inability to put both bottom cheeks on the chair, the cups knocked over onto plates, with chicken nuggets now swimming in water, and a devastated child demanding new ones right away and extra crispy. I dreamt of a time when every day might not feel so hard. It shimmered beyond my reach, tantalizing in its promise of peace. If I followed the steps and stayed on the path, we would get there. And once I got there, I could rest. I was a woman chasing a dream that never arrived. I did not see my parenting story reflected anywhere. So, in my mind, we were the only ones failing. The kids were too wild to attend most social gatherings, and I was too tired to care. Disconnection haunted every corner of my life. I struggled to sleep. Nightmares came like ocean waves, crashing endlessly. Some mild, and others so violent they slammed me to the ground, disoriented and sore. Despite the cool winter air, I would sweat through my clothes. At the heart of the pandemic, after trying 4 different school settings over the course of 4 months, my son Michael went into what we now know was autistic burnout. He watched YouTube for 12 hours a day, alone in his room under a blanket, eating processed crunchy snacks. He did not look at me or speak to me. He was furious, an active volcano, either silent and rumbling or spewing hot lava. My heart ached for connection with my son, and I was terrified. I didn't know about autistic burnout yet. We hadn't even heard the term low-demand parenting. All I knew is that he was suffering deeply. I knew that isolation and endless screen time were not signs of health for a 6-year-old. And, at the same time, we got to this point because I pushed and pushed. What would happen if I released instead? What would happen if I trusted that this, too, had a role to play? I always knew that this child was very different from his peers, that we had a zebra in a world of horses. When I handed over the completed autism screening to the nurse at his 2-year-old checkup, I nearly ran into the hallway to call her back. "You're not asking me the right questions," I wanted to say. "I've got boxes to check. My child checks boxes." But I doubted and blamed myself, suppressing the power of my intuition. And I said nothing. Several years later, at the end of an occupational therapy appointment, I summoned up my courage and stumbled through asking his therapist if we should pursue an autism evaluation for Michael. I brought up his mix of sensory sensitivity, difficulty communicating, intense interests, and emotional dysregulation. She downplayed my concerns using flawed and outdated knowledge of autism. "He is empathetic and feels deeply. You have nothing to worry about. I wanted to correct her. I wasn't worried. I was hopeful. I was desperate for some expert, some guru to say, yes, we've seen this before. Yes, you're right. You can trust this intuition. It didn't feel right, but I believed her. Another tiny dream died. A dream that there might be a name for a kid like mine. A dream that there was a community out there who would understand. A dream that Michael needed something different than the world around him, because he was a world unto himself. For the first 6 years of Michael's life, I leaned on the traditional parenting paradigm and pored over the same volumes as everyone else, desperate to find a way to bring calm and normalcy to our out-of-control family life. I began to call these parenting experts my choir, because they sang together around certain themes. Kids need boundaries. You are the adult. You must be in control. When kids misbehave, it's because the parents are messing up. You have to stay calm, because calm, connected parents have kind, gentle kids. These books filled me up with shoulds, all the things I should be doing to be a good parent, to wrangle my zebra into a bit and saddle like all the other horses. And it wasn't just the books. The parenting culture all around me seemed happy to fill in the gaps with judgment, side-eye, and casual commentary about some other parent who was too permissive, whose kids ran all over her, and who needed to get control of her children. Fueled by desperation, I began to investigate my son's possible neurodivergence. I made lists, a notebook filled with lists, lists of lists. Every page had one of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders criteria for diagnosing autism written at the top, and listed below were the pieces of evidence. Except, instead of being examples from my son's life, they were examples from mine. My research brought me to the inescapable opinion that I might be autistic. I was terrified, because I was discovering just how desperately I wanted to be autistic. My terror was not of this new label. I was terrified that I would lose another way to belong. I was desperate not to fail at being this type of human, too. In the summer of 2021, just a few months apart, my son and I were both diagnosed with autism. Michael received his diagnosis from cold and clinical Duke University Autism Center, complete with one-way mirrors and endless forms. And 4 months later, I got my diagnosis over Zoom from a perky and fidgety middle-aged woman who is autistic and ADHD herself, complete with nervous laughter, rambling answers, and a deep kinship. When I looked at myself in the mirror, a new self blinked at me, freshly awakened, bleary in the bright light of day. An autistic self filled with self-knowledge, dreaming new dreams, dreaming of letting it all go. It felt like a miracle, this brand new thought. Am I allowed to let things go? I don't have to worship at the altar of consistency and desperately fear the evil of being permissive? What about all my other gurus who say that kids are always testing boundaries and need their grown-ups to hold firm so they can feel safe? Admittedly, this strategy is failing spectacularly in our case. This was the first time that I wondered whether it was my strategy failing and not me. Suddenly, I had new eyes to see these failings and failures. Our life had been falling apart, but I wondered if those words were true. Something was falling apart. The pandemic stripped away some. Our present reality stripped away much more. The touchstones that told me we were okay failed and fell away. But if life wasn't falling apart, what was? I joined an online support group of other parents whose children were anxious and explosive like mine. I recognized myself and my kids in so many stories. I was told over and over that it was good that I was asking these questions while they are still young. I was assured that there was plenty of time to change, that it is never too late. I got pictures of where this path would lead if I did not get out of the way, if I continued to insist and enforce and draw boundaries that kept us trapped, rather than leading us out of this maze. More than anything, I received the self-compassionate message that kids are doing their best with what they have, and so are their adults. We do not escape the maze for our kids alone. Our own liberation is bound up in theirs. In this support group, I first heard the words pathological demand avoidance, PDA, a little-known profile of autism. The first time I read the words, PDA is an anxiety-driven need to remain in control, I felt my stomach drop. I stayed up way too late, absorbing every drop of information I could find. This was real. This had a name. At last, I found a community that could help me see, understand, and connect with my suffering son. PDA is a neurobiological condition that wires with an extreme and pervasive need for autonomy and control. Any perceived threats to that freedom produce a panic-driven anxiety reaction. PDAers will fight, flee, faint, or fawn as if their lives literally depend on it. Diagnosing and identifying PDA in children is a complex challenge, as it is not yet included in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, which is used by clinicians to diagnose accurately in the United States and is used as a gold standard around the world. In the United Kingdom, PDA can be identified as a part of the autism diagnostic process, according to their NICE guidelines, which include demand avoidance as a criterion of autism. The National Autistic Society in the UK has issued detailed profiles for PDA and diagnostic criteria to aid clinicians. Because of the challenges with identification, rigorous studies are also lacking. That said, PDA adults have engaged in tremendous advocacy and training, enabling parents and clinicians to get the best possible data, that of lived experience. Like a child who has experienced complex trauma, PDAers have a hair-trigger nervous system. They explode without warning to the ordinary demands of everyday life. In order to heal and thrive, many PDAers require a low-demand parenting approach, including releasing tiny, subtle demands, like responding to a question with words or eating at a certain time. My son Michael was one of those kids. He needed me to release all the other parenting methods I relied on and to root out all the false ideas that lurked beneath. He needed radical trust and acceptance so that I could show up wholeheartedly in the low-demand lifestyle he required. I began by telling my children, "I think I've made a mistake. I don't think rewards and punishments actually work for you. I think you are doing your best all the time." I nodded along with my own words. I am doing my best all the time. I looked at my suffering child, and I finally felt free from all the shoulds that screamed in my ears that good parents don't give endless screen time, and good parents don't feed processed food, and good parents don't have children who rip up all the books on their bookshelf. I was beginning to trust my child more than the chorus of judgmental parenting experts that endlessly sang in my ears. I wanted to trust him enough to let him heal in his own way and to follow his own instincts. his PDA body and brain would lead him toward what he needed to regulate, to rebuild, and to heal. Whether it was the standard approach or not, it was what he needed. I trusted that this too was good, that this too was right, and that this too would lead him forward on his unique life's journey. Trust also meant honing my own parenting instincts, learning to listen to my own wise inner voice instead of the many other voices that clamor to tell me what to do. Finding inner wisdom and intuition is a crucial part of the story. As I accepted my true self, I unfolded in trust for my children. One of the fiercest tethers that kept me locked to the mainstream path was my fear of being a bad mom. I so badly wanted to be good. I was raised by a neurodivergent mother, and I saw the judgment and shame heaped on her in the 1980s in a conservative culture that saw any deviation from the norm as a violation of the code of good motherhood. Deep inside, I nestled a kernel of commitment. I would never step off the path and be shamed as she was. Sadly, that very conviction kept me locked in cycles of fear, blame, and shame that nearly led me into total breakdown. Acceptance moves like a dance in families, a swirl of mutuality. But the true transformation of radical acceptance started with accepting myself. As I learned to see my life through the eyes of neurodiversity, not broken or wrong, but different and good, I gained eyes to see my children as they are. As I accepted my own limits, needs, and disabilities, I accepted my children, limited, needy, and struggling in a world not built for them. And as I practice loving kindness towards myself,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.